Welcome back as we continue with our examination of Thunderf00t's second video in his Hyperloop Busted series. We're picking up the video starting at around 9.5 minutes in. In much of the rest of this second video, Thunderf00t engages in a lot of scaremongering, but in the end, he doesn't quantify the risks. While it is true that there are scenarios in which passengers can be killed on the Hyperloop, this is also true for any other form of transport. It's hardly the case that no one ever dies with cars, airplanes, and trains. It's not enough to merely say there are risks. They must be quantified and compared to alternatives. Thunderf00t completely fails to do so. At 9:33, Thunderf00t points out that a rupture of the pod's cabin could kill the passengers. Actually, he does far worse.
There's another problem. People also need air to live, so if there's any rupture in the Hyperloop capsule for any reason whatsoever, you will die in the Hyperloop in pretty much exactly the same way that you would die in deep space.
He boldly declares that any rupture of the pod, for any reason, would kill the passengers. However, the paper clearly details on page 54 what contingencies are in place for a decompression event. Hyperloop capsules will be designed to the highest safety standards and manufactured with extensive quality checks to ensure their integrity. In the event of a minor leak, the onboard environmental control system would maintain capsule pressure using the reserve air carried on board for the short period of time it will take to reach the destination. In the case of a more significant depressurization, oxygen masks would be deployed as in airplanes. Safety of the onboard air supply in Hyperloop would be very similar to aircraft and can take advantage of decades of development in similar systems. In the unlikely event of a large-scale capsule depressurization, other capsules in the tube would automatically begin emergency braking, whilst the Hyperloop tube would undergo rapid repressurization along its entire length. Since humans are capable of surviving in a vacuum for up to a minute, and possibly even as many as three, these contingencies effectively eliminate cabin decompression as a life-threatening scenario. Come on, Thunderf00t, you're not even trying to be honest with this garbage you're spewing. Further, Thunderf00t fails to address the likelihood of such an event. It stands to reason that the pod cabins would be more reliable than commercial jets. After all, airplanes are subject to weight limitations that require the fuselage to be light enough to fly. The Hyperloop, on the other hand, uses a different mechanism for levitation and thus can be built with a sturdier cabin. Also, unlike jets, the Hyperloop does not have to contend with potential bird strikes. For these reasons, one can reasonably assume that, while certainly not free of all risk, Hyperloop pods would probably be safer than commercial aircraft in this regard. And keep in mind, commercial aircraft have one of the best safety records of any mode of travel.
People won't be able to hear you call for help, because, as alien informless, in space, no one can hear you scream.
Oh, come on, now you're just being stupid. Obviously, the pods would be equipped with sensors to detect the loss of cabin pressure and radio the information to a control center. I refer you to page 54 again. It's amazing what you learn when you actually read the proposal.
The velocity of the capsule is about that of a bullet fired from a gun, except it's a 15-ton bullet. Any failure whatsoever will rip through that 2-centimeter outer tube like candy.
No, it wouldn't. Do bullets rip through the barrels of the guns that fire them? No, they slide along it. The pods travel parallel to the surface of the tube, so their relative velocity to the wall is effectively zero. As long as the air cushions are made of a material that's somewhat softer than the steel tubing, the pod would simply slide along the inside of the tube in the same way a bullet slides down a gun barrel. This would not be fatal to the passengers, because the coefficient of friction would be less than 1, meaning that the pod would slow to a stop at a rate less than 1g. Thunderf00t's next argument is based on a flawed conception of compressible fluid dynamics. I can't fault Thunderf00t for this, the physics involved are incredibly complicated, so hold on to your hats, folks, it's gonna be a bumpy ride! See what I did there? In order to understand where Thunderf00t went wrong, we have to take a crash course in compressible flow. Let's examine the physics behind a convergent nozzle. Suppose you have a source of high-pressure gas on the larger side of the nozzle and low-pressure gas or vacuum on the smaller side. Naturally, the gas will push itself from the high-pressure region to the low-pressure region. As it does, the gas expands by accelerating down the nozzle. In doing so, the temperature, density, and pressure drop in accordance with thermodynamics and the ideal gas law. The drop in pressure associated with increased velocity is known as the Venturi effect. But an interesting thing happens if the ratio of high pressure to low pressure exceeds a certain limit. At this point, the gas reaches the speed of sound, and rarefaction waves can't propagate against the flow to cause any increase in mass flow through the throat. However, the gas coming out of the nozzle may still have some residual heat and pressure, and thus it continues expanding and accelerating beyond the speed of sound. In order to further accelerate the gas in a useful manner, a divergent nozzle must be used to redirect the expansion and generate sustained flow with a velocity over the speed of sound. This system is known as a convergent-divergent nozzle and is the basic principle behind most rocket engines. Yes, this really is rocket science! Physicists often simplify this phenomenon by stating that you need a diverging nozzle to accelerate a gas beyond the speed of sound. But this is only true for sustained flow and doesn't apply to the leading edge of a pressure wave propagating down a long straight tube like the Hyperloop. We can actually calculate the maximum velocity the gas can reach with this equation. Maximum velocity equals the square root of 2 times C sub P times T sub T, where C sub P is the constant pressure heat capacity and T sub T is the stagnation temperature, in other words, the temperature of the gas before it starts moving. According to Engineering Toolbox, the constant pressure specific heat capacity is 1.005 kilojoules per kilogram Kelvin. Let's assume a temperature of 20 degrees Celsius, or 293 kelvins, which is 68 degrees Fahrenheit, fairly common in Central California. Plugging these values into our equation, we get a maximum velocity of 767.4 meters per second. Of course, in real life, this value will be slightly less as the small amount of air pressure on the inside of the tube will prevent the incoming air from expanding completely. So the air entering the tube is limited to the speed of sound, while the leading edge of the pressure wave is limited to just over 700 meters per second. This is important because according to the conservation of mass and the Venturi effect, the pressure must smoothly transition from 100 pascals at the leading edge of the pressure wave to a figure a little less than 1 atmosphere at the rupture. Still with me? I'm really impressed if you are. We're dealing with some pretty advanced physics, but I think I've said enough, so let's go back to Thunderf00t's criticisms. From 1140 to 1603, Thunderf00t delves into a very long-winded and highly speculative explanation of how a few bullets could cause a cascading failure that would kill everybody in the Hyperloop. In it, he makes quite a few ridiculous assumptions. He argues that a few bullets can cause an air pocket, which will cause the forward compressor to explode, which will cause the pod to crash through the tube, which will result in a wall of 1 atmosphere air moving down the tube at the speed of sound, which will destroy the capsules. Let's go through these assumptions one by one. First, what would happen if someone did shoot a few holes in the Hyperloop?
If, say, for instance, there's a pocket of high-pressure air because someone shot a few holes in the Hyperloop, then the turbine is all of a sudden going from running at 1/1000th of an atmosphere to hitting a pocket of air at 1/10th of an atmosphere.
That figure sounds a bit high. I bet he just pulled it out of his ass. Any bets on how far off he is? As I mentioned above, the air coming in would expand rapidly down both directions of the tube. Let's assume the bullet shot at the tube is a 50 caliber BMG, one of the most powerful rounds available to the public. It's worth mentioning that even the armor-piercing version of this round is only rated to penetrate 19 millimeters of steel, not the 20 to 23 millimeters of steel proposed for the Hyperloop. However, this is for a range up to 1,500 yards, and we did find a video of this round being fired at multiple layers of half-inch steel body armor plates where it penetrated 2, but not 3 layers. So it looks like the round would just barely be capable of penetrating one side of the tube and embedding itself on the other side if the terrorist could get close enough. It's also worth noting that the Hyperloop could be made completely bulletproof simply by doubling its thickness. This would effectively double the cost of the tube, but that's only a 10% increase in the cost of the entire project. It's also completely unnecessary, as we'll see. A 50 caliber bullet would punch a hole about 1.26 square centimeters in size. The cross-sectional area of the tube, on the other hand, is 3.90 square meters, and since expansion would occur in both directions, this gives us a divergent nozzle area of 7.80 square meters. This gives us an expansion ratio of 61,900. In short, this would result in a localized overpressure of only 1.64 pascals, a pressure increase of less than 2%. However, Thunderf00t throws out a figure of 1/10th of an atmosphere, which is over 10,000 pascals. He's off by a factor of 6,000. The second stupid assumption was that hitting the overpressure would cause the compressor to explode.
That is going to have 100 times the force acting on it, which is the sort of thing that causes blade failure.
This is nonsense. In part because the actual increase would be more like 2%, but even if we grant Thunderf00t his totally laughable figure, as I explained, this pressure gradient would rapidly stretch down the tube, so the compressor would slow down gradually as pressure built up. It wouldn't explode, it wouldn't even cease powering the air cushions. And SpaceX knows this. As they said in the paper, a minor depressurization of the tube is unlikely to affect Hyperloop capsules or passengers and would likely be overcome by increased vacuum pump power. Any minor tube leaks could then be repaired during standard maintenance. The third assumption is that an exploding compressor would cause the pod to crash through the wall of the tube.
Any failure whatsoever will rip through that 2-centimeter outer tube like candy.
Also nonsense, as we explained. The pod would probably just slide down the tube coming to a stop after a significant distance, even if the automatic emergency brakes didn't deploy. It wouldn't even kill the passengers of that one pod. The fourth stupid assumption is that this would cause a wall of air to move down the tube at the speed of sound.
But you can still expect it to kill pretty much anything it hits. I mean, you get a rough idea of what a 1 atmosphere pressure wave will do from some nuke benchmarking tests. Well, what about the people trapped inside this 600 kilometer long steel tube? Well, there's a wall of air traveling down towards them at about the speed of sound, essentially a shockwave, and it'll kill everyone in the capsule when it hits them.
As I demonstrated, this would not be the case. Within seconds, the pressure gradient will have stretched out over several kilometers. So instead of a jarring change in pressure comparable to a blast wave from a nuclear bomb, what we'd actually see is a gradual buildup in the pressure of the air surrounding the pod. Not only that, Thunderf00t completely ignores the paper's proposal for emergency repressurization valves along the length of the tube for just such an emergency, which would automatically activate if the system detects a rupture. Once again, page 54. And the fifth stupid assumption is that the pods will be destroyed by a 1 atmosphere pressure differential.
Now, of course, you have to hope that the emergency brakes are good enough and the capsule strong enough to survive being hit by that 1 atmosphere pressure wave. And honestly, I've got my doubts about that, because these capsules are designed to run at 1,000th of an atmosphere.
Oh, come on! Just because the capsules normally operate at 1/1,000th of an atmosphere doesn't mean they couldn't be designed to handle a 1 atmosphere pressure gradient. In fact, the capsules have to stop for boarding and disembarking, don't they? That would be in 1 atmosphere, wouldn't it? Or does Thunderf00t think they'd all have to board wearing spacesuits? And while it is true that flow choking may result in a buildup of pressure approaching 1 atmosphere, as demonstrated in our first video, this would not expose the passengers to lethal accelerations, nor would it be difficult to engineer a capsule capable of standing up to this pressure. Here's a good comparison to help visualize the pressure gradient we're looking at. Imagine a Hyperloop pod 10 meters in length being submerged in water nose first until its rear is at the surface. That's the kind of pressure we're dealing with. Phew, that was a lot. So let's stop here for now. The good news is you're through the worst of it. The physics in the rest of this series shouldn't need to be anywhere near this advanced. But this does seem like a good point to leave off until our next video. So stay strong and be free.